Hello, I'm Jonathan Watson, pastor at Cape Fear Presbyterian Church. Grace and peace to you in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Welcome to this week's worship service from my kitchen table. Holy is the Lord. Let us pray. God of desert days and wilderness nights, we rest in the comfort of your presence and trust in the sustaining power of your love. Provide us with all that we need to live abundantly and serve with abandon. Amen. Hear these words from the book of Exodus, chapter 17, verses 1 through 7. From the wilderness of Sin, the whole congregation of the Israelites journeyed by stages, as the Lord commanded. They camped at Rehadim, but there was no water for the people to drink. The people quarreled with Moses and said, "Give us water to drink." Moses said to them, "Why do you quarrel with me? Why do you test the Lord?" But the people thirsted there for water, and the people complained against Moses and said, "Why did you bring us out of Egypt to kill us and our children and livestock with thirst?" So Moses cried out to the Lord, "What shall I do with this people? They're almost ready to stone me." The Lord said to Moses, "Go on ahead of the people and take some of the elders of Israel with you. Take in your hand the staff with which you struck the Nile and go. I will be standing there in front of you on the rock at Horeb. Strike the rock and water will come out of it so that the people may drink." Moses did so in the sight of the elders of Israel. He called the place Massah and Meribah because the Israelites quarreled and tested the Lord, saying, "Is the Lord among us or not?" Author Paul Gooder writes, "It is hard to overcome fear sufficiently to follow God's call in the first place. It is even harder to persevere with this call when the going gets tough." This is true for most of the people in the Bible, as well as modern-day believers like us. In this instance, however, the author is speaking specifically of the people of Israel as they journeyed from Egypt to the so-called Promised Land. It's along this journey that we find our passage for today from the book of Exodus. The Israelites' leader was Moses, who was asked by none other than God to undertake the task of freeing God's people from Egyptian captivity, which he's accomplished. And they're now safely on the other side of the Red Sea and out of Pharaoh's reach. But it didn't take long for the weight of what the people of Israel would have to endure just to get to the Promised Land to settle in. Almost immediately after crossing over the Red Sea, it's safe to say that their going got tough. And their faith began to waver. They even wondered aloud if life would not have been better had they stayed in Egypt. In verse 3 of today's text, where the complaint du jour is about a lack of water, they cried to Moses, "Why did you bring us out of Egypt to kill us and our children and livestock with thirst?" Imagine the situation being so terrible that remaining enslaved was preferable. Now, this was not the first time the people of Israel had complained. In fact, one can see a pattern developing. They encountered a threat to their well-being. They complained to their leaders, i.e. Moses. Moses took it to God, and finally God intervened in various ways, in this case by providing water. We see this pattern repeated over and over again. The Israelites sure were a cranky lot. Okay, maybe that's a bit unfair. Over the years, as I've preached on the Exodus, I have tended to be a little sarcastic in referencing the Israelites' unpleasant temperament. Perhaps I have failed to truly take into account the stressful environment that living in the wilderness surely was. After all, I don't think any of us have the kind of firsthand knowledge that comes with literally wandering in the desert for 40 years, led by God or anyone else. It had to have been difficult. They were undoubtedly exhausted and irritated. I can recall some long road trips with my parents and brother that sometimes tested our collective patience. But at least we had a car. Given all that the people of Israel have had to endure and would endure, their grumbling over food and water and the like might be justified. They did get their water from a rock, no less. Yet the passage ends with these words: "Is the Lord among us or not?" It strikes me that these words, or something similar, have been said by any one of us. These cries could be voiced by everyone trying to survive the COVID-19 pandemic. Is the Lord among us or not? These words could surely be uttered by anyone in the small town of Phoenix, Oregon, a community of roughly 4,500 people in which over 1,000 homes were destroyed by wildfires last week. Is the Lord among us or not? I imagine some in the communities of Gulf Shore and Foley, Alabama have expressed these words as they continue to dig out from the devastation caused by Hurricane Sally. Is the Lord among us or not? Think about how many times you have wondered about the presence of God. Our wilderness may not be a desert-like place, and we may not have had the same exact experience as the Israelites, but each of us has gone through or is going through something that feels like we may be lost in the wilderness. And despite reassurances to the contrary, we sometimes think that God is still absent. Our journey through life moves between fear and trust, worry and hope. We call out to God and to others who travel with us and long to know we are heard. And more importantly, that there will be a response. What's important for us to glean from this text today is the reminder that despite the Israelites' apparent wavering faith, God never gave up on them. And God will never, ever give up on us. In verse 6 of our passage, when Moses was searching for water on their behalf, God told him, "I will be standing right in front of you." Even though we may fail to notice or appreciate what God is doing, God still says, "I'm right here with you." God does not leave God's people alone in the wilderness. God responds with mercy and grace. In the case of the people of Israel, God led them out of slavery, through the wilderness, and into the promised land. The question of whether or not the Lord is among us is answered elsewhere in the Old Testament, including in Isaiah, where God, speaking through the prophet, says, "Do not be afraid. I am with you. I am your God. Let nothing terrify you. I will make you strong and help you. I will protect you and save you." And in Zephaniah, where God is again speaking through the prophet, "The Lord your God is in your midst, a mighty one who will save. He will rejoice over you with gladness. He will quiet you by his love. He will exult over you with loud singing." The question of whether the Lord is among us is also answered in God's Son, Jesus Christ. For as Jesus proclaimed to his disciples in the Gospel of Matthew, "Remember, I am with you always to the end of the age." Friends, none of us are promised a wilderness-free life. There will be frustration. And there will be times when we feel alone, when we wonder, is the Lord among us or not? Instead of giving in to doubt and fear, reach out to the Lord. Assured by Christ, we can be confident of God's sustaining presence at all times and in all places. In Jesus, God gave us hope and showed us once and for all time that he is with us always. Thanks be to God. Amen. us pray. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, ruler of the universe, for you have provided for your people. You have turned manna in the wilderness into the bread of life. You have turned water from a rock into a spring of everlasting life. You have turned law into love. You have made yourself known to us. You, Lord, are the one who makes life bloom in the desert. We give you thanks for your creating spirit, creating still, and for the hope of your promise. Where people still wait for the fulfillment of your promise, give a glimpse of your glory. Where people have lost hope, breathe your peace. Where we have turned our eyes away, choosing instead only to see what we think we already know, call us once again back to your way and your truth. May your justice spring up in the desert like a river, your love grow as tall as the trees, until your whole creation thrives in your kingdom. We come today bearing the hurts of the world, seeking your forgiveness, seeking your healing, seeking to know your presence with us as we walk this journey. Walk with us, Lord, and speak. Walk with us and show us your transforming grace at work in places we have left behind, in people we have dismissed, in action and word together. Walk with us. Hear us, O Lord, as we offer you the prayers of our hearts, silently or aloud. We pray all these things in the name of Christ, who taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Friends, our worship ends, but now our work begins. May the amazing grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the extravagant love of God, and the ever-present fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all this day and always. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.